My paper is entitled Mr. Karski Goes to Washington, and I am going to do this in under 15 minutes. And as you'll see, there's so much, this is such an incredible person that I really can't do it justice in under 15 minutes. You would need more than 15 hours to do justice to this person. But at the very end, I'm going to show a couple of books if you want to dig deeper, and a documentary video, which is wonderful. Okay. Jan Karski was born to a, is that volume okay? Yeah. Jan Karski was born to a Roman Catholic family in Poland in 1914. Before World War II, he completed law school and he trained to be a diplomat. In 1938, at the age of only 24, he joined Poland's Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And it looked like he had a bright diplomatic career ahead of him. He was fluent in a number of languages, and he has a wonderful near photographic memory. But then in September 1939, World War II begins. Early in the war, Karski, who had joined the army as an officer, he's taken prisoner by the Soviet Union, which at the time was allied to Nazi Germany. Later, as part of a prisoner exchange, Karski is handed over to the Germans. And fortunately, en route to a POW camp, Karski escapes, and he makes his way to Warsaw, where he joins the Polish underground. In 1940, Karski begins work as a courier, transporting information between the Polish underground and the Polish government in exile, which initially was in Paris, and then after the invasion of France, it moved to London. During one such mission in July 1940, he was arrested and tortured by the Gestapo. Amazingly, he escapes German captivity yet again, so that's twice in German captivity, once in Soviet Union captivity, and he returns to active service with the Polish underground. In 1942, Karski was chosen to undertake a secret mission to London, England, to brief the Polish Prime Minister in exile about Nazi atrocities in Poland and in Eastern Europe. Before he left for London, Karski was approached by two Jewish leaders who had heard of him and knew of his connections to the West. According to Karski, quote, "They described to me what is happening to the Jews. They described to me that the Jewish problem is unprecedented." The word unprecedented comes up a lot in Karski's writing. "That the Jewish problem is unprecedented and cannot be compared with the Polish situation or the Russian or any other," end quote. The Jewish leaders asked Karski to bring news of the plight of Europe's Jews, not only to the Polish government in exile, but to the people and to the politicians of the Western allies. They told Karski, the Jewish leaders meeting him clandestinely, told him, quote, "Hitler will lose this war, but he will exterminate the Jewish population. The allies cannot forget that the Jews will be exterminated totally in Poland," end quote. The Jewish leaders asked Karski to ask the Western leaders to make an official public declaration regarding the extermination of the Jews in Europe. They also asked that millions of leaflets be dropped over Germany, informing the German population just exactly what their government was doing in the East. And they also wanted the Allies to threaten, if the Holocaust wasn't stopped immediately, they wanted the Allies to threaten Germany with targeted bombing, not of military targets necessarily, but of significant German cultural targets. Karski agrees to transmit this information to the West on his trip to London. Then one of the Jewish leaders makes an extraordinary request of him, quote, "You will give them your oral reports, but I am sure it will strengthen your report if you are able to say, I saw it myself. We can organize for you to visit the Jewish ghetto. Would you do it? If you do, I will go with you to the Jewish ghetto in Warsaw," end quote. And at its peak, the Warsaw ghetto, it was the largest of the Nazi ghettos. At its peak, there were almost 400,000 Jewish men, women, and children held there. Karski agrees to go into the ghetto, and within a few days, he and his escort enter the Warsaw ghetto through a tunnel. Years later, when Karski is describing this journey through a tunnel into the Warsaw Ghetto, he compares it to the River Styx, connecting the worlds of the living and the dead. Over the course of 2 days, at great personal risk, Karski and his escort walk slowly through the Warsaw Ghetto. To quote Karski, "My job was just to walk and observe and remember the odor, the children, dirty, lying. I saw a man standing with blank eyes. I asked the guide, 'What is he doing?' The guide whispered, 'He is dying.' I remember degradation, starvation, dead bodies lying on the street. We were walking the streets and my guide kept repeating, 'Look at it, remember this, tell them, remember this, tell them,'" end quote. Karski later said of his visit to the Warsaw Ghetto, "This was not a world, this was some hell." The Jewish leaders then asked Karski if he would be willing to visit a camp for Jews. Again, Karski agrees. He's in his 20s, by the way, as he's doing this. Karski agrees. Days later, disguised as a Ukrainian guard, Karski was smuggled into an overcrowded transit camp run by the SS called Izbica or Izbica. There he witnessed thousands of Jewish men, women, and children being brutally crammed into cattle cars, taking them to be murdered at the Belzec extermination camp. Karski was deeply shaken by what he witnessed. Even 30 years later, you'll see, if anyone's interested in the video I'm going to mention at the end, you can see him tell this story, and 30 years later, he is in such distress simply sharing what he saw. Even 30 years later, Karski is visibly pained when recalling the details of his visit to the ghetto and to the transit camp. Having witnessed hell on earth, Karski's next task was to alert the world to what he had seen. He makes the dangerous journey across Nazi-occupied Europe to London, where he delivered his report to the Polish government in exile and to senior British authorities, including Foreign Secretary Anthony Eden, who a few years later would be Prime Minister. According to Karski, Eden showed little interest in his report of what was happening to the Jews in Poland. In July 1943, Karski brought his eyewitness report to Washington, D.C. With the assistance of the Polish ambassador, the 29-year-old Karski had a one-hour meeting with President Roosevelt in the Oval Office. President Roosevelt apparently did most of the talking and asked a variety of questions about the overall situation in Poland. Realizing that their meeting was almost over, Karski brought up the matter of the fate of the Jews in Poland. Quote, quoting Karski, "Mr. President, before having left Poland, I was charged with this mission by the most important Jewish leaders. The situation is horrible. Without outside help, the Jews will perish in Poland." End quote. Karski politely characterizes President Roosevelt's reply as rather non-committal. That's a very polite way of expressing what FDR did and did not say. Without mentioning the Jewish situation, FDR tells the young Karski, so this is Roosevelt talking, "Tell your leaders that we shall win this war. The guilty ones will be punished for their crimes. Justice and freedom shall prevail. The American people are friendly to your country. They will help with your country after the war. You will tell your nation that they have a friend in this house," that being the White House, end quote. Roosevelt extends his hand to shake. Karski shakes his hand and he exits the Oval Office. And for the rest of his life, Karski felt like his meeting with Roosevelt, who he characterizes as a lord of humanity, someone with great power to get things done, Karski for the rest of his life considered that meeting a failure. Karski's next high-profile Washington meeting is with Supreme Court Justice Felix Frankfurter, a close advisor to the president. Accompanied by the Polish ambassador, Karski was able to go into more detail with Justice Frankfurter than he did with President Roosevelt. He was able to describe the inhuman conditions that he witnessed with his own eyes in the Warsaw Ghetto and in the Espicha transit camp, as well as inform him about details about the larger Nazi program of Jewish extermination. Justice Frankfurter listened for 20 minutes, so he did better with Frankfurter than he did with Roosevelt. Frankfurter asked Karski if he was aware that he, Frankfurter, was Jewish. Karski said yes. Frankfurter then said, so here's Frankfurter's reply after hearing this report, eyewitness report. Young man, I am no longer young. I am a judge of men. Mr. Karski, a man like me talking to a man like you must be totally honest, and I am telling you that I do not believe you. End quote. The Polish ambassador, Ambassador Chechenowski, stood up and said to Justice Frankfurter, Felix, you don't mean it. You know about him. He has come from afar. He has met with the president. He has been checked and rechecked 10 times in England and here. Felix, he is not lying. Frankfurter replied to the Polish ambassador, Mr. Ambassador, I did not say he is lying. I said I don't believe him. These are different things. My mind, my heart are made in such a way that I cannot accept this. No, 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 end quote. Years later, Karski would say of his meeting with Frankfurter that he thinks the judge did believe what Karski told him, but that he lacked the ability to comprehend and make sense of what he was hearing. Needless to say, once again, Karski was thoroughly disheartened by his meeting with powerful people in Washington. But to his credit, Karski did not give up. In 1944, he authored a first-person account of Poland in Hitler's Europe, the story of a secret state, which became a bestseller. It's a wonderful book. It reads like a spy novel. So because the book did well in America, Karski then embarked on a book tour, and he gave lectures throughout the United States, which he used as an opportunity to influence public opinion and to increase American awareness about the Holocaust. But for the rest of his life, Karski was haunted by what he considered his failed mission on behalf of Europe's Jews. After the war, Karski chose to remain in the U.S. rather than return to now communist Poland. He earned his PhD at Georgetown University, where he taught for 40 years. Here's a picture of him in his later years. In 1982, Yad Vashem in Israel awarded him the honor Righteous Among the Nations. In 1994, he was declared an honorary citizen of Israel. Karski died in Washington, D.C. in the year 2000. According to one of his biographers, quote, there could hardly be another person who felt more deeply, painfully, and bitterly the abandonment of Poland by the Allies in World War II. Jan Karski was a man who, tragically, had to feel that his own prodigious efforts on behalf of the Jews of Europe and on behalf of his briefly independent native land were an utter failure. Regarded as a hero in both Poland and Israel, his was a heroism not of triumphs, but of extraordinary integrity and courage, end quote. In 2012, Karski was posthumously awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom, America's highest civilian honor, by President Barack Obama. I will give the last word in my talk to President Obama, who at the White House Medal of Freedom ceremony said of Karski, quote, we must tell our children about how this evil was allowed to happen, because so many people succumbed to their darkest instincts, because so many others stood silent. But let us also tell our children about the righteous among the nations. Among them was Jan Karski, a a young Polish Catholic, who witnessed Jews being put on cattle cars, who saw the killings, and who told the truth all the way to President Roosevelt himself. That's the end of my talk, and I'll just mention here, the first two are books. That's the book he wrote in 44, a new updated edition with an introduction by Madeleine Albright, came out in 2013. And then there's a wonderful biography which Karski participated in called Karski, How One Man Tried to Stop the Holocaust. And there's a great documentary, it's only an hour and 10 minutes, called Karski and the Lords of Humanity, in which you will see and hear Karski sharing these same stories that I just did, but in more detail and as a first-person witness. So thank you very much.